Stiletto snakes are totally unorthodox. There's nothing typical about them. They're small, they're wiry, they don't work like normal snakes do.
It's almost impossible to handle these snakes without being bitten.
Has the longest fangs of any snake per head ratio. So they have these extremely long fangs that come out the sides, makes them almost impossible to handle.
They're called stiletto snakes because their fangs swing out and it actually looks like a stiletto heel, pointy and quite long, and they bite with a stabbing motion to the side. So that makes them impossible to hold behind the head. Because stilettos prey on mammals and we are mammals, the venom is specifically dangerous to humans, and that's why it has such a digestive effect on your finger.
So I get this call from the ER, and they said, oh, we got an unusual snake bite here. It's an exotic. It's a stiletto snake.
I've been working with this group of animals for about a year, so I was more comfortable than I should have been.
He was transferring the snake from one container to another.
I had a hook in one hand, and I'm holding the lid with my left hand.
The snake reached over and
managed to hit my thumb 3 times before I even realized what happened.
And it happened so quickly he wasn't sure that he was envenomated until he saw blood coming from the wound.
And as the blood stopped, that's when it hit me. Uh-oh, I've been bitten, and it's a venomous bite.
A lot of people feel like if they get bitten by a snake that they're gonna die. I think that Myke is knowledgeable about snakes, but it may have made it even more scary because he knew he could die and he knew there was no antidote.
My first reaction was to immediately dump it back in the box and close it. And start calling people and letting them know, I'm gonna need help. I'm gonna be down for a bit.
I got a hold of him about an hour after he was bitten and tried to put him at ease. I told him that he was gonna be in intense amounts of pain.
Should the pain become so extreme, I'm not able to instruct those around me. I wanted a level head to explain to them what was going on, because I knew stiletto bites infamous for being very painful.
After realizing it was a full envenomation, he described this radiating pain starting in his thumb and progressing up his arm and into his chest.
I tried not to think about the venom spreading.
Once the venom's underneath the skin and in the subcutaneous tissue, it spreads locally with spreading factors that are in the venom. And then it'll go through the bloodstream, it gets pumped through the body, and the tissue will start to swell and distend, and that hurts.
The pain kicked in, and I was a mess. My father really wanted us to go to the hospital. He was really, really, really stressing out. With no anti-venom, I knew the hospital wasn't gonna be able to do much. At this point, it's pain management. The experts my doctors would call would have been myself and my associates.
There are very few documented cases of stiletto bites in Africa and none that we know of in the United States. And in a case like Myke's, there's a lot of uncertainty.
Bite. Grab my hand. Come on. Bite.
So the possibility that Myke could die was very real.
At one point, my blood pressure shot through the roof and my pulse crested the 200 mark, which was pretty intense. And we decided if it stayed there, we'd head to the hospital.
The stilettos have a few novel toxins in their venom that aren't found in any other snakes. One of them is an endothelial toxin, which basically increases your heart rates and blood pressure. And this is extremely dangerous, obviously, in prey items as well as human beings.
We knew this was pretty much standard protocol for the venom, but actually experiencing it and reading about it are completely separate things. We just kept watching the pulse. We saw the 200 number, and as it hit that high point, that's the point of, is it gonna keep going? Because the heart can't sustain that.
The venom will cause your blood pressure to go up, but so will pain, and there can be an additive effect there. So it probably increased the fear factor as well.
Initially, it just started to swell. The swelling progressed and became redness, and the redness became blood blisters. This was just within the first several hours.
I mean, a lot of what venom does is it digests. And so the venom was digesting him, basically.
The blood blisters began to merge and become one giant blood blister. And by the end of 24 hours, it was a massive, larger than my thumb, hematoma. At this point, it's pain management. I knew if I went to the hospital, there was a risk. They're gonna cut to relieve the pressure.
It's an extremely weird position in knowing that there's no care out there that's gonna save your life.
I'm used to treating snake bites with anti-venom, and I think that I almost didn't realize how much good the anti-venom does for the pain.
I kind of felt like I had a large boulder dropped on my hand, and the crushing pain moved up my arm, and it felt like every muscle in my body was just being torn.
During these periods, he would be laying in bed, sweating, and being in a lot of pain, and not being able to do very much other than just sit there and watch his thumb rot away.
After the first day, the hematoma, it began to loosen up. And so now the skin's gone from stretched out and shiny into a oily, leaking surface as the skin began to let the blood from the hematoma leak out through it.
What'll happen is these blisters, they'll decompress on their own, they'll drain. That's just how the body responds to the damage that's done to it. I mean, it swells and distorts, and that's what it looks like.
From there, it was a nightmare, it was a blur. I was on my couch, chewing through rubber spatulas. We took the rubber spatula part off a baker's spatula, and after I chewed through the first two we had at home, my wife went out and purchased more rubber spatulas. And even through those, I damaged my teeth.
The pain rose to such a level that eventually he sought medical care. He knew one of the world's leading ER doctors and venom specialists, Dr. Sean Bush, was at Loma Linda Hospital.
The very first time I saw him, I was afraid that he could lose part of his thumb. And I could tell that it was rotting. And then eventually, his thumb started to smell.
It was like having a dead rat at the end of my hand, and it smelled awful.
It absolutely looked like something out of a science fiction movie. It was fairly disgusting.
Venom digested my thumb just as I had seen it digest thousands of mice before.
You couldn't give anything to stop the progression of the damage, and so it would just get worse.
It looks like a space alien slug on the back of my thumb.
Because at some point, it's going to stop progressing, and you say, okay, it's run its course. Now we can take away the tissue that looks like it's devitalized.
We went home, and over the period of the next several days, it started to turn yellow, which was not a good sign. My nail bed was completely black, also not a good sign, and it was starting to lose shape. It was starting to become concave on the fingerprint side. We scheduled an appointment with the surgeon.
Even the hand surgeon scratched off the part about amputation off the consent because he was hopeful that the thumb would be able to be salvaged.
Because it was his impression there was live tissue under the dead skin. When he went in there, he found that underneath the dead skin was liquefied flesh and tiny pieces of what was bone.
After the first surgery, the distal metatarsal was gone and the bone was protruding out of the flesh.
His thumb had basically liquefied, and we call that liquefaction necrosis. And that's what would be expected with venom unabated, just going in there and doing tissue destruction.
It actually digested the bone. It went straight through, and all that was left was skin. So it really wasn't an amputation. They took the skin off and the rest fell apart.
Now bone, you can't just leave bone exposed to the air. So we had a plan to cover that with skin and tissue.
You don't realize how sensitive your bones are until they're exposed to open air. So we ended up having to do a procedure.
They're gonna make a cut in the groin, pull that tissue over the thumb so that it covers the thumb.
And for 3 weeks, my thumb was sewn into my groin to grow the skin back over the bone.
Once the tissue grows over that, it'll be detached. He will have a little bit of tissue there that can be shaped so that it can be functional thumb tip.
I've had a couple relapses since the bite already. And it's as if I just got bit all over again. The bite's been since healed, doesn't hurt anymore, and then, little of nowhere, crippling pain. Like, you're back in bed. You're out sick for the day because you can't handle the pain from the bite. And that's one of the unique aspects of stiletto snake venom that's not well researched and really should be. I would never recommend someone skip the hospital after a snake bite. If you get bitten by a snake, go to the hospital. This may look really bad, but I'm very fortunate. The result I had is directly contributed to the team I was working with and the great medical care in the United States. This would have been much worse anywhere else, and I'm just grateful for that.